I don't need to tell you that any discussion of the army and society should not be seen in isolation from the wider strategic context. And I just want to say a couple of points about that wider context. We are in the process of, to use an Americanism, coming to the end of the wars of 9/11, with an exit of major forces by, I think now, early 2015, not late 2014. And we're seeing an ongoing change, transatlantic, I think, and a shift from ambitious, labour-intensive military operations to what I would call, in work about to appear, labour-light operations. We can see this looking back to Libya, to Mali, potentially even Syria, with much less focus on ambitious and intensive boots on the ground. And I think you heard yesterday, there is therefore a potential for short, sharp shock actions, preferably with local partners doing the longer term spade work for stability. So that labour light does not necessarily mean casualty free. I think that's my first punchline. Secondly, and this is a point directed at the armed services may well, and the minister hinted at this more than once, may well have a lower social profile than it has had for the last 10 years or more. And I think this is most especially the case for the British Army. The Army's centrality, or if you like, good times, in terms of profile at least, may well be coming to an end, and certainly for quite a while to come. Funding priorities, austerity, and strategy point in the same direction. Greater European cooperation, a realisation of modest power ambitions for the United Kingdom, while at the same time a continuing nagging uncertainty and anxiety over the ability to continue to cooperate with the technically advanced United States, which remains a key guarantor of UK security. Which takes me to my third point, the public and the armed services, and some of the work that we are doing just coming out at King's. As the Minister alluded to, there are remarkably high levels of support for the armed forces, despite opposition to the missions they have undertaken, particularly Taliban and Herrick. 83% report high or very high opinions of the UK armed forces, while 95% report having some or a great deal of respect for them. And higher levels of respect are reported for the armed forces than either for the police or for the medical profession. That said, 58% thought it was wrong to go to war over Iraq, and nearly half, 48%, felt the same way about sending troops to Afghanistan. That said, there are high levels of support for troops returning from missions, and those high levels of support are independent of the level of opposition the public or sections of the public feel about those missions. This research is not an isolation, which would be considered an isolation. I think we can say reasonably confidently that in the United Kingdom and North America, by that I mean Canada and the United States, the public can and do distinguish the mission from the troops. I think that is the lesson of the last decade. But it's interesting also to note that that support is accompanied by what I would call patchy public knowledge and understanding of what the armed forces actually do. So support doesn't necessarily mean familiarity. Just to give one example, which I thought was very striking, this will be coming out shortly. The public significantly underestimate the levels of support given to personnel, both serving and ex-serving personnel, by the Ministry of Defence. They do not see what the Ministry of Defence provides, which has interesting reputational implications for that government department. Reassuringly, service personnel do, unlike the public, recognise and appreciate the support that they are being given, whether serving or ex. Which takes me to my fourth point, Michael. There is, when we look at the public, and we are seeing this just now, a serious potential for elite public splits or divisions on questions of future use of force in military interventions outside the United Kingdom. Syriza is just the latest example of a government facing opposition both from within the executive, from within the legislature, and from what very good journalist Benedict Brogan has called, very pithy phrase, a weary and a wary public. We saw some of this, I think, with regard to Libya, when, my reading of the situation at least, is the public were frankly taken aback by government definitions of humanitarian success as regime change. That came as a bit of a shock, and I think it accounted for the haste and anxiety felt within government circles over how long that mission was taking to achieve success. The lesson from that is the public can be ignored, but it's in extremis, but it's extremely tricky to do so. This, I think, we are seeing in the United Kingdom as elsewhere, is one of the heritages of the Blair government of 2003. That public trust has eroded, suspicion, caution, not just weariness and wariness, are with us for some time. Which takes me to my fifth point. There is, and I think the Minister is quite right to warn us about this, there is a potential for the level of public support for the armed forces to wane post-2015. We would be foolish to be complacent on that front. With the lower profile of the military after the Afghanistan exit, the press of other spending priorities, there is, to be frank, a risk of indifference. Public support for the military historically comes and goes, it ebbs and flows. The charities, on or off the record, depending who you talk with in the charities are actually, to be frank, concerned about this. Just now, there's lots of money around for all of them. They would say five, six, 7 years, that may well change. They're quite anxious about it. Which takes me to my sixth and seventh point about public military connections. We have heard more than once this morning about reserve forces. I do not want to sport with your intelligence and talk about the strategic rationale for the shift in the regular reserve balance, or the recruitment and retention issues surrounding them, and whether the objective for that regular reserve mix is realistic. What I do want to emphasize is that the reserve forces help to offset the reduction in the profile of the armed forces, because smaller forces will increase the distance between military and society. That distance can be offset by the increased role of reserves. And that's where business, as we have heard, comes in. Something I think that's important, and we don't know enough about this, we should do in future, is the consequences of super garrisons and return from Germany. I think this is fascinating. In some parts of the United Kingdom, relations between the army and society will be closer, let alone the stability for military families being produced by these garrisons. But in other parts of the country, perhaps distance will be greater. We do not know enough about this, so I think it's an interesting question to ask. Which takes me to my last 2 points, 8 and 9. I don't need to tell you how important it is, and we saw this in the last few days, that the military be present in society physically. The importance of the uniform. It was nice to see uniforms outside the conference venue. Uniforms are an essential part of the umbilical cord between military and society. And there's an interesting question need to tell you about this over the last few weeks, about whether security is more important always than presence. And I think think we know a lot about that. This is not going to go away as a problem in terms of terrorist threats and so on. There's an interesting balance, therefore, between security of personnel and the importance of showing the public face of the military to our society. Another part of the, still on my penultimate point, another part of the presence is the importance of minority representation in the armed forces. This is a very serious challenge in terms of recruitment, retention, and military-society relations, which I want to emphasize. The most recent statistics published by MOD indicate that there are 650 Muslims serving in the United Kingdom armed forces. Of these, 550 are in the British Army, about 0.5% of the total. Muslims make up 2.8 million, or about 4% of the British population. That's going to double by 2030. So the interesting challenge for the armed forces is, if the armed forces should represent society, what is it going to do about that gulf? And even in business terms, if you look at the demographics, and those of you who read my report done for the British Army, will realise that if you look at the age profile of potential recruits, you know where the happy hunting grounds are for recruiters. So it's not just a citizenship argument for more Muslim soldiers, it's also just a hard-nosed business argument too. The last thing, which I'm sure you're thinking about anyway, my ninth and last point, is the way in which we academics as well as military personnel, on the civil and the military side, are digesting the Supreme Court rulings. That the Ministry of Defence can be sued for negligence, that the scope of the Human Rights Act should be extended, and that the traditional doctrine of combat immunity should be interpreted pretty narrowly. This will have an as yet unknown impact on military commanders. We can say two things, though, on which I will end, about that ruling. And it's too early to be definitive, but I think two things are worth saying. One is that it might make governments on the political civilian side more cautious than they would otherwise have been about deployments. And insofar as they wish to deploy, they may well wish to alter the balance between technology and people, thus accelerating the focus on drones and other technologies. So it will alter the political calculation of how to use forces and interventions, which will add a spin to what I called labour light operations earlier. The second thing in this audience that I think I'd like to stress is that the Supreme Court ruling raises something that's at the heart of military culture. We can argue about different military cultures, the army's not the navy, and so on. Okay, so this is just about the army. One of the most important features of military culture is risk-taking. And in my courses, I always distinguish between risk-taking and recklessness. And I think built in the DNA of any decent soldier is the need to take risks to get the job done. This Supreme Court ruling and the wider opinion it reflects is not going to go away. So the question is, not, I wish we were in another place. The question is, how are you going to organise, manage, risk-taking to achieve the political objectives of government in the context of that ruling? I'm not giving you an answer, I'm just stating the question. And it shows how troubling it is to live in this turbulent armed forces and society relationship, which changes faster sometimes than we can